Well, folks, welcome to the next installment on our program on marketing. Now, in this program, I want to deal with a very specific example. We have a lot of marketing theory, and therefore I'd like to start with an example so that we can relate theory to practical examples that you can see. And I pick for your for this program a study on the motorcycle market, because this has been a very volatile and changeable market in the last 2 years, with the entry of a large number of new brands, especially the Japanese motorcycles. The scooters have expanded a lot, new scooters and motorcycles have come in, and the whole market has therefore changed and has moved very rapidly from being a seller's market to a buyer's market. And therefore, what earlier was only a problem of selling is now become a problem of marketing. Now, the first question that we must ask ourselves in any marketing situation is, what is the product we are selling? Now, a product is not something that anyone buys to give a favor to the manufacturer. You don't buy a cake of soap to oblige an industry. You buy a cake of soap because you are exchanging a few rupees of your hard-earned money for certain benefits that you get out of it. You get the benefits of feeling fresh, of feeling clean, of smelling nice, of looking like a film star, or whatever benefit that you feel that a soap is supposed to give you. Now, similarly, let us see what are the factors you'd consider when you're buying a motorcycle, a scooter, or a moped. Now, I've just, for your convenience, brought out a very simple table of some of the factors you may consider. Actually, you may not be aware that you're considering them, but when you're selecting one brand against the other, or you're selecting a scooter against a motorcycle, these will be some of the factors which you would consider. Some of these factors are tangible, measurable, physical, chemical factors, and some factors are intangible, psychological factors. Now, the tangible factors you'd consider is something like styling. Does this model look better than the other? You could consider power. You may want to have a more powerful machine. Now, power doesn't only mean the horsepower. It doesn't only mean the number of, whether it's a 350cc or 100cc. Power can also mean pickup. Power can mean acceleration. Power can give the, if the acceleration gives you the sense of being able to command the roads, that is the power you want. Another sector of the economy may be concerned about fuel economy. Reliability is a factor you would consider. Safety, if one machine is safer than the other, it's a factor which you could well consider. The comfort, the service and spare parts that are available. Now, these are some of the measurable, tangible, physical properties of the various motorcycles and scooters that you may consider. But these are not the only reasons. There's also the intangible factors. The status. There's no doubt that some motorcycle scooters give more status than others. There's a novelty value. When the Japanese motorcycles, the Suzukis, the Hondas, the Yamahas, and the Kawasakis came in, they had a high novelty value, certainly in the beginning. But that value is changing. It's now in a competitive market. All these products are available. This no longer has the value that it had when they first came in. And finally, you have a factor called resale value. Now, this was a very important factor for some motorcycles and scooters, especially a scooter like the Bajaj scooter. One of the important reasons why people bought it was it had a large resale value, so that after using it for 3 or 4 years, a user could sell a Bajaj scooter and still be able to have had a free ride for the entire passage they had. It is an important reason why you should buy a product. Now, these are factors which you cannot engineer into your product, but they are important factors which evolve out of your marketing, and they are the factors which determine the choice of whether you should buy a motorcycle or a scooter. Now, let us take a practical example, because all these values are not of the same weight, and therefore, let us see how, in a practical situation, what will go on inside the mind of a customer. So let us say, hypothetically, our customer is deciding on whether he should buy a scooter or a motorcycle. So for argument's sake, let us say he takes the most popular scooter, which is the Bajaj, and he takes the most popular motorcycle, which is the Rajdut. Now, you may not believe it, but the Rajdut still remains the most popular motorcycle despite all the Japanese 100cc's which have come in. It may not be the most popular motorcycle in the cities, but in the small towns and villages, it is still the most popular motorcycle because it has an important factor in terms of the fact that it is still is a motorcycle which can be repaired by any street repairer. It is a motorcycle that any dudwala can use. It can go into rural areas. It can take the rough and tumble and can be handled everywhere. This is an important reason why it is doing well in the rural areas, but it is not doing as well as, say, the Bajaj is doing, which is undoubtedly the commanding vehicle as far as the urban areas are concerned. Now, in terms of styling, I don't think either Bajaj or Rajdoot will score very highly in comparison to the new motorcycles that are available. But let us say that if we were to give 10 points each, for argument's sake, power and pickup, Bajaj would be low and Rajdoot will not be very strong. If we were comparing this with, let us say, the Yamaha would probably get 15 points as far as power and pickup is concerned. But on economy, on the other hand, Rajdoot will do extremely well, so you'll get probably 15 points. Now, the Bajaj, in terms of fuel consumption, is not very good. But most of the scooter users don't go long distance, and therefore they're not very sensitive to fuel economy. Therefore, in absolute terms, in terms of the fuel efficiency standards, the motorcycle, the scooter, may not be as good as a Rajdoot or the new 100cc motorcycles, but the scooter user who basically buys the Bajaj scooter as a poor man's car, where he can put his children and a suitcase while he's driving down the street, is not sensitive to power, so economy, so therefore you'll probably get something like 10 points on that. Now, in terms of reliability, both Bajaj and Rajdoot are very good. I would give them, say, 15 points each. In terms of safety, the Rajdoot is very good. The Bajaj is not very good. No scooter, it's nothing to do with the Bajaj, no scooter is as safe as a motorcycle. Scooters have a very high tendency towards head injuries and a high tendency to accidents because the driver is only balanced on it. A motorcycle, which is driven astride, has a much higher factor of safety, as any insurance statistic will show you. However, this is not a factor which the customer is aware of. So actually, I would not go down to 7, I'll move it up to 10, because what is right is not the reality in the absolute terms. The reality is in the mind of the customer. It's in his head, it's in his mind, and it's in his heart. And if he feels the Bajaj is a safe vehicle, then a safe vehicle it is. Now, in terms of comfort, both of them are quite average. I would say the Rajdoot is quite comfortable as motorcycles go, and the Bajaj has nothing seriously wrong with it. Now, service and spare parts should be an important part. All manufacturers pay a lot of attention to it, but it is something that customer doesn't think about when he's buying a motorcycle or scooter. It's something that is important to build up the value, build up the resale value, build up the reputation of a motorcycle, but it is not something which a customer thinks about very much. So you probably get something like 5 points each. Now, in terms of status, well, I think Bajaj would probably outscore the Rajdoot. In terms of novelty, neither score anything compared to the new motorcycles. But in terms of resale value, I would say Bajaj will get a solid 25 points and the Rajdoot will get nothing. Now, this is therefore a comparison of a hypothetical example of the kind of factors which a customer considers in his mind when he's deciding to buy one model or the other. Now, you will find that the total of these scores will obviously not be the same. But what will make a great difference is the price. Now, in actual fact, the price of the Bajaj has been influenced very much by the resale value, which in turn becomes a negative factor because it is not available. You have to wait 2 years to get a Bajaj scooter, and as a result of that, because you have to wait, your alternatives get much reduced. Or you have to pay a higher premium in order to get the motorcycle, to get the scooter, and therefore that again changes the equation between the values of the two products. But this is a hypothetical example to explain to you that the first starting point, the building block of any marketing, is the product itself. You have to try and understand by research, by analysis, by even intelligent guesstimates, what are the properties, what are the factors that a customer considers when he buys your product. Because it is on the strengths and weaknesses of your product that your marketing is based. If your product has, for example, got a good economy position, this is something that you must exploit in your marketing, in your advertising, and so on. If, on the other hand, let us say that the awareness of your safety is low, we know that the safety is very high in a Rajdoot, but the awareness is very low, then perhaps that is a subject that we can enhance so that we can pick up the value, we can pick up the points and add value to our products all the time. All products are, however, not the same to all people. And different segments of the market see different values which are important to them, because every customer is interested himself. What a man is interested is not the same as what a woman is interested. What an old man is interested is not the same as his son or his grandson. Now, therefore, when we look at the marketplace, we have to also break it up or segment it into relevant segments which are into which different products have to find their position of command. Now, in the motorcycle or scooter market, there will be a market for students, there will be a market for service people who are employed in government or industry, there would be people, tradesmen, shopkeepers, there would be industries who would buy motorcycles or scooters for their messengers, insurance salesmen, for their service and spare parts salesmen. There would be some independent buyers, and there would be rural buyers. Now, all of these are separate segments who buy motorcycles or scooters to meet their specific requirements. Within these segments, there will be also behavior differences between the young students who just left school under 19 years old. There would be a different behavior group in the young college or young working class in the 20 or 25 year old age group. There would be a different behavior group in the 26 to 35 year age group, and in the older segment of 36 year old and so on, there would be a different buying behavior. Now, you in the streets of your city will see a lot of young people driving motorcycles, but actually statistically you can see that the biggest segment comes in the age group of 26 to 35. This is the area where most of the motorcycles and scooters are found. The young groups they'll go for the smart, flashy motorcycles, but the older people would like to have a secure, solid, comfortable, dependable machine. So therefore, every segment of the market has its own requirements. These numbers were developed from a survey done by NCAER some years ago, and these have been updated in terms of the approximate behavior patterns that have been shown by more recent surveys. Now, as you can see, that different products will command different segments of the market. Now, the young students, or the young service people, or the younger age group, this segment, for example, are liable to go in for the new 100cc motorcycles. On the other hand, the Bajaj will dominate the very substantial segments of this area, the service, trade and commerce, all this segment. These big areas are where Bajaj will be dominant, and this is why they are the largest selling bi-wheel in the market. The Rajdoot is also quite important. It does very well in this segment. In the agriculturalists, a lot of independents, some of industry and trade, and some service people. But therefore, every motorcycle, every scooter has its own and different segment. Now, therefore, the Rajdoot does not compete very much with the Yamaha or the Bajaj or the Kawasaki or the Hero Honda, because these go to the younger, smarter set. On the other hand, the Bajaj also doesn't compete very much with this. They go into the older, middle-income set. So therefore, every product has to define where its own area of command has to be, which segments of the market it wants to command, because it is in that area that it derives its strength. And when a motorcycle or scooter wants to enter the market, it has to select a very specific target in terms of where it wants to go. These segmentation exercises are extremely important for another reason. Now, when you're doing your advertising, what type of person do you want to portray? If you portray a Rajdoot with a very smart, flashy young person, it's not likely to be able to be very meaningful to the people who are its regular buyers. On the other hand, if you introduce a new model, as Rajdoot has recently, with improved styling, with a number of other features, and it wants to make an entry into this market, then that's a flanking attack which is perfectly valid. On the other hand, the ordinary standard Rajdoot is in this market, and if it attempts to try and improve its image by putting flashy young people on the motorcycle, it's not going to help its own customers. In fact, it will only confuse them. Similarly, the Japanese motorcycles, the new Japanese motorcycles which have come in, the Indo-Japanese motorcycles, for them it is very valid that they should show acceleration, smart set, smart styling, and all the rest of it. Now, even within age groups, you have another phenomena which is called psychographics. Now, you see this a lot in cigarette advertising, for example, that the even within an age group, you have people who are mature or who are adventurous or are daredevil, and therefore the psychological attitude in terms of whether they're aggressive or whether they're responsible are also factors which you have to consider, because you can break up the market not only in demographic considerations, not only in considerations, because it's not really very important to us in terms of whether what is the education or what is the religious factors in a particular area. But the occupation, age, and psychographics are frequently the factors which are extremely important for for marketing of a product like motorcycles. Now, the segmentation or product benefit of a product are never constant, because the market is changing all the time. Consumer habits are changing, prices are changing, the cost of petrol is changing, the competitive alternatives are changing, and this has a bearing on all these values. So therefore, marketing men do not have the opportunity of being able to stay constant, but they've done a survey 3 years ago and that survey is relevant today. It is not. In fact, during the last 2 years, there has been a major upheaval in the entire bi-wheeler market. There were, till 2 years ago, the total sales of motorcycles were three brands, was Royal Enfield, Yezdi, and Rajdoot, were selling about 200,000 units a year. And suddenly, the government opened licensing for 600,000 units of the new four new Japanese units, first of which was the In Suzuki, which came in 1985, and it took off like a rocket. It had an extremely high novelty value, as I'd explained to you earlier, and it had very good performance. It was a trouble-free, reliable, and an economical machine. And in 1985, it took off, as I say, extremely well, and was followed soon after by the Hero Honda, which overtook it in 1986. And in 1986 started the Yamaha motorcycle, which has started picking up and is now doing very well. And in 1987 only, the Bajaj Kawasaki has come into this market. Now, let us also see what this did to the market. Now, first of all, it had a very serious effect on some of the older motorcycles. The sales of Enfield and Bullet, Enfield and Yezdi, were cut to an extent of about 30% straight away in 85 and 86 compared to the levels they had earlier. Even the Rajdoot suffered a little bit. It suffered quite a lot in the cities, although it did fairly well in the, as I say, in the rural areas. Rajdoot tried to therefore restore its position by bringing out a new, improved styled, improved performance deluxe model, in which they have been able to regain some part of their market position. But now let's take a look at what happened in the Japanese motorcycles. Now, the In Suzuki is an 8 horsepower, 8 bhp. It's surprising that for 100cc, the Japanese motorcycles gave almost as much power as 175cc Rajdoot or 250cc Yezdi. Now, the In Suzuki came in first and did very well. Then the Hero Honda was able to particularly emphasize the importance of fuel economy. And its advertising campaign, Fill It, Shut It, Forget It, absolutely summed up to every customer the fact that the fuel economy of the Hero Honda was absolutely incomparable to any other motorcycle, and it caught the popular imagination to the extent that the element of fuel economy became the most important factor. After this came the Yamaha. And the Yamaha started slowly because it had a much more horsepower. Its BHP was 11 compared to only 7.5 as compared to of the Hero Honda. In other words, it had 46% more brake horsepower, and obviously its fuel consumption had to be higher. It was just as fuel efficient, whereas fuel consumption was higher. And right now, in 1986, the customer was concerned about fuel consumption and not fuel efficiency. And the Hero Honda had established a position for itself. Now, in this situation, suddenly we found that the Isuzu started losing its position. Why was this? Because the marketplace, the warfare, that the battleground for the customer is in the customer's mind. And in the customer's mind, the Hero Honda was commanding the mountain of fuel economy, and Yamaha was gradually beginning to command the mountain of power. And in Suzuki, therefore, neither was as good as Hero Honda on economy, nor as good as Yamaha on power, and therefore it was not on a mountain of its own. Even though initially it was on the commanding position in the small motorcycle market, gradually that mountain began to subside, and the two new mountains, the big mountain of economy and the smaller mountain of power, began to emerge, with Hero Honda on top of one and Yamaha on top of the other. Now, in 1987, Kawasaki, the Bajaj Kawasaki, has come in with a motorcycle very similar to the Yamaha. It's almost identical in terms of power, performance, and most of the other parameters, and therefore it is not a particularly better or worse motorcycle on any measurable criteria, but therefore it's in a disadvantaged position of trying to move somebody who's commanding a mountain place. And the person who's in a defensive position always is in a position of considerable advantage. Therefore, the marketplace right now is extremely flexible and mobile, as the consumer's mind is shifting and adjusting to the perceptions of the different products which are coming in the marketplace. Okay, so now we've spent some time on the product and the customer, and we've talked about the product in terms of its values and in terms of its pricing. Let us now talk about distribution. Because even if we have the best product and we have the best pricing, if we do not have a good distribution, our product cannot sell. The distribution means that how we get our product closest to the customer, how we get the whole chain of command through the dealers, distributors, retailers, as the case may be, so that the product is as close, so the customer has the least inconvenience of getting to to your product. Now, a lot of this depends on the type of product you have. Now, if you're selling machine tools, let's say, take an example of HMT, they would not have dealers or distributors. The manufacturer would deal directly with the customer. They would, however, have to have very high-level salesmen, very high-level service people, very high-level contact. They would have spent a lot of time with the customer in order to understand their requirements and meet it. On the other hand, at the other end of the spectrum, you will have a consumer product. Now, as I say, HMT will deal with maybe a few hundred customers around the country. On the other hand, Hindustan Lever, selling soaps or toothpaste, will be probably dealing with as many as 500,000 retailers and God knows how many million customers. Now, therefore, it is physically impossible for the manufacturer to deal with so many retailers and so many customers. So, therefore, the retailer has to be close to every customer's household. The retailer must be serviced by stockists. The stockist must be serviced by distributors, and therefore you have a long chain of distribution from the manufacturer down to the customer. Now, in between, you have a product like a motorcycle or a tractor. Now, in this, we are dealing with an intermediate sales agency who is not only selling the product, but who has to provide service. Because any durable product like a motorcycle, a tractor, or a entertainment electronics has to have service backup. Service and spare parts have to be there, because the customer can't go back to the manufacturer every time he has a problem. And therefore, the manufacturer has a responsibility to make sure that his dealer is an extension of the company in terms of the quality of salesman, the quality of service personnel, the warranty service, the spare parts availability, so that the product that the manufacturer gives the customer is maintained in the field at all times to the manufacturer's standard. During the last 2 years, there's hardly any product left which is in a seller's market. Every single product, whether it is textiles, whether it's consumer products, whether it's motorcycles, whether it's scooters, whether it is electronics, whether it's television sets, is in a highly competitive situation. And it is the policy of the government that competition is the only thing which will protect the customer. It is only through competition that the manufacturers have to give a bad, good product, because there's no room for a bad product. As long as the customer has a choice, he will not take a bad product, and if he has a bad product, he will complain about it, and everybody will know about it. He has to improve his service, he has to control his prices, he doesn't have the option of putting up the prices when he wants to, because if he takes up the price, he will lose market share. And therefore, the whole ball game has changed. The market has moved from a seller's market to a buyer's market, with the result that the type of people and the disciplines required for marketing have also changed. In the old days, the marketing man was nothing but a rationing officer who basically controlled the distribution of products to the different locations. Today, the marketplace is shifting to one of a marketing management where you have to fight every inch of the marketplace, and you cannot leave a weakness in your system at any point. You cannot leave a weakness in your product, in your distribution, in your pricing, in your promotion. You have to make sure that you are protected on all points, because if there's one weak link in your chain, your entire chain will break.